Morning, everyone. You're very welcome at the bank here today to talk about the December Financial Stability Report. Before we start, I should remind you that there's a monetary policy decision coming up in a couple of days, so we're well into the blackout period now where we can't talk about monetary policy decisions. That's not to say we can't talk about interest rates, and there's obviously a bunch of stuff in the report that we'll want to touch on that, but no speculation on the MPC decision, please, if that's all right. We'll deal with that when we get to Q&A. I'm joined today by the Deputy Governor for Financial Stability, John Cunliffe, to my far right. To my left, Sam Woods, the Deputy Governor for Prudential Regulation, and to my right, the Governor of the Bank, Andrew Bailey. Andrew has some opening remarks, and then we'll turn to questions. Thanks.
Well, thanks, Jamie, and welcome to the press conference for the December Financial Stability Report. Before answering questions, I'd like to highlight some of the key themes of the report coming out of the FPC's Q4 round and its policy meeting. And in particular, I'd like to draw out the backdrop to the latest report and what that means for households, businesses and banks. The FPC's decision on the countercyclical capital buffer, the recent financial stability risks we faced in the gilt market from liability-driven investment funds, and the broader work we're doing to tackle the risks posed by non-bank financial institutions. So let me start with the backdrop to the report. Increases in the cost of living are stretching finances and making it harder for households and businesses to service their debts. Higher interest rates and the expectation that they will rise further are, of course, adding to that. Monthly payments on around 4 million owner-occupied mortgages are expected to increase over the next year. However, overall households are more resilient now than they were in the run-up to both the 2008 financial crisis and the early 1990s recession. The proportion of disposable income spent on mortgage payments is expected to remain lower than the peaks during both of those stresses. A combination of higher costs, lower demand, rising rates, and continued supply chain disruption is putting pressure on businesses. But in aggregate, firms are less indebted than in the previous periods of stress. The UK banking sector is resilient to an economic downturn much worse than the one currently expected. As a result, banks are able to support creditworthy households and businesses through this downturn. The strength of the banking sector reflects the large capital and liquidity buffers that banks have built up because of the policies put in place after the 2008 financial crisis. Let me turn now to the countercyclical capital buffer. In July, the FPC increased the CCYB rate to 2%, with this rate due to come into effect in July next year. Today, the FPC is maintaining the rate at 2%. The global and UK economic outlooks have deteriorated and financial conditions have tightened in response. Consistent with the judgment we made in July, vulnerabilities that could amplify economic shocks in the future do remain. Maintaining a neutral CCYB at 2% helps to ensure banks continue to have capacity to absorb any future unexpected shocks without restricting lending in what would be a counterproductive way. The FPC will, of course, continue to monitor this situation closely, and we stand ready to vary the UK CCYB rate depending on how the risks evolve. I'll turn now to the resilience of liability-driven investment funds. Today's FSR highlights some of the recent financial stability risks which the UK faced in September and October of this year. These risks arose when rapid and large movements in market interest rates on UK government debt exposed weaknesses in liability-driven investments, those LDI funds. These funds act as investments for many defined benefit pension schemes. The interest rate moves led to a spiral of margin and collateral calls and forced government debt sales that risked leading to further market dysfunction. This was particularly concentrated amongst so-called pooled funds. Given the material risk to UK financial stability, the Bank of England intervened with a temporary and targeted programme of UK government bond purchases. That action was successful in restoring market functioning and giving LDI funds time to build their resilience in the near term to future volatility in the gilt market. Today's FSR sets out the importance of improving longer-term resilience in the LDI sector in a number of ways. Some very welcome steps have already been taken, however, further work will need to be done next year. And in this context, the FPC has made a recommendation to relevant regulators to preserve increased resilience and then set out appropriate steady-state resilience, including in relation to operational and governance processes around it. I'll now turn to the resilience of market-based finance. This recent episode involving LDI funds also underscores a broader set of financial stability risks from non-bank financial institutions. Today, more business lending and other financial services come from institutions other than banks. The sector includes many different types of firms operating from many different countries. Over the past 3 years, we've seen risks crystallise in a number of areas across this sector. I'll just give them some of the most well-known examples. The Dash for Cash in March 2020 showed how sudden spikes in liquidity needs during a stress can be amplified by vulnerabilities in non-bank finance. High levels of hidden leverage through equity derivatives was a key factor in the default of Archegos in March 2021. Which led to sizable losses for banks. Significant volatility in commodity markets earlier this year highlighted vulnerabilities in these markets with unexpected and sharp increases in margin requirements. And the most recent episode involving LDI funds also demonstrated how market moves can be amplified by vulnerabilities in non-bank finance. All of these episodes demonstrate the urgency of developing and adopting policy reforms to increase the resilience across the sector. The Global Financial Stability Board has a comprehensive international work programme in train to do this, which the UK fully supports and is contributing to. That work programme focuses on a number of specific areas, including increasing the resilience of money market funds and open-ended funds, improving margin practices, understanding and addressing the risks posed by decentralized finance and crypto asset markets, and understanding drivers of illiquidity in core funding markets, including leverage in the non-bank sector. Alongside this international work, the Bank of England will continue to tackle vulnerabilities with specific domestically designed actions, where that is effective and practical. We will develop our stress testing approaches to gain a better understanding of the resilience of the sector to shocks, and its links to banks and financial markets. Given this, today we are setting out that the bank will run an exploratory scenario exercise focused on non-bank financial institution risks. So to conclude, the economic environment is challenging. We have high inflation, demand is slowing, and interest rates have been rising. Household and corporate finances are under greater strain. Overall, however, both households and businesses are more financially resilient than they were in previous periods of stress. And thanks to the policies put in place after the 2008 financial crisis, banks are more resilient. They are now in a position to support customers and lessen the economic stress rather than amplify it as they did in the past. Non-banks have become an increasingly important part of the financial landscape, however. And recent events remind us that regulatory reform to improve the resilience of non-banks is both necessary and urgent. So I want to leave two key messages. First, a robust and well-capitalised financial sector is better protected against financial instability and thus more able to support customers through difficult times. And these two elements, financial stability and customer support, beneficially interact. Second, Brexit provides an opportunity to reset regulations to fit the UK as a single country, and we will do our part in that. It's not a matter of universal deregulation, but rather getting regulations that suit our case. The post-financial crisis regulations have served an important purpose. The system is more robust. But the mere passage of time does not mean those regulations are no longer needed. Far from it. They should be kept relevant and amended as such, but we should eschew this time is different type arguments. Thank you.
Thanks very much. We'll turn to some questions now. If you could wait for the microphone and identify yourself at the beginning, that would be great. Can we start with Phil?
Phil Aldrich at Bloomberg. You talked about stress testing and the non-bank financial institutions. Does this mean that you're going to be expanding your sort of regulatory remit to include the shadow banks? Because I don't think the bank itself has a remit for that. And also, you talk about international progress should be made in 2023 on this kind of crackdown on the shadow banking sector. There's been talk about closer regulation of this sector since 2010, and nothing's happened. Nothing much has happened. Why is 2023 going to be different?
Yeah, thanks, Phil. I'm sure John or Sam will want to come in. On the regulatory remit, I'd make a distinction here between what I call sort of micro-regulation and macro-regulation. On macro-regulation, the FPC's remit goes very broad. In fact, it goes as broad as it needs to go. What, of course, then has to follow through, though, is how conclusions of that are actually put into effect. And, of course, that requires micro-regulators sector regulators, if you like, to act on it, because the FPC is not a micro-regulator in that sense. Now, there is a provision within the legislation for the FPC to make recommendations on that to the government, because it's obviously rightly a decision for Parliament, ultimately, as to where the regulatory perimeter is set. And, of course, as you'll know, we've got legislation currently in Parliament and going through Parliament, which will reset the perimeter in some respects, crypto being probably the best example of that. So where in answering your question, I think the FPC obviously has to make choices over where it focuses on what is a very big landscape. And I think hopefully you'll see that what I've described is a sort of a summary of where we think those choices need to be made and how they need to be made. In terms of following through, I'm not saying it necessarily requires a change to remit. I think it does require a change to focus. I mean, you'll see in the in the conclusions of the policy meeting that we have made a recommendation this time. We don't always make formal recommendations, but this time we have, and it goes to the area of defined benefit pension schemes and the pensions regulator. It's not saying we should change the perimeter, but it is saying that I think that we need more focus on what I call the financial aspects of regulation in that area. On the international progress, the post-financial crisis reforms, as I've sort of said at the end, were very much rightly focused on the banking sector. What we've seen, and I'm not sure we should be surprised at this, is a shift in the relative weight of bank and non-bank financial activity in the last sort of, 15 years really, since the 15 years since the financial crisis. And you're right that in the Financial Stability Board, there has been a focus on this for some years, not quite probably as far back as you mentioned, but some years. If you said your precise question, why is it different now? Well, I think it's different now because, what I said, we've now got a whole series of non-bank incidents, if you like, across different jurisdictions, and I think it is absolutely critical, first of all, to recognise that this is a sector that is highly internationally diversified. I mean, give you the obvious example with the LDI funds, that the pooled LDI funds, which were the main source, I think, of the sort of challenge we had, are in almost all cases actually based in outside this country, in other jurisdictions. So that emphasizes why it's so important. Money market funds is another example of that in our case. But I think what makes it the more pressing, and certainly this is a view we strongly hold, that the progress is made by the end of next year is of course what we've seen. It is now much more pressing.
I might say a couple of points. One, the FPC doesn't have powers of direction on non-bank finance, but it has, as the Governor said, wide-ranging powers of recommendation, including on the regulatory perimeter, but also comply or explain recommendations to both the PRA and the FCA. So I think the FPC is in a position, I think, to make pretty strong recommendations if it wants to. The second is this is an exploratory stress test, not the annual stress test that we do of banks. We are in the middle of an annual stress test of banks, but this will be the first time that we've tried to do an exploratory test essentially on liquidity stresses in the system of banks, insurance, pension funds, investment funds, clearinghouses, just seeing how the whole system operates together. That's a much more complicated task, and I think we're developing kind of new ways of approaching that. You can see some of those kind of new approaches in the document we just published on the stress test we carried out on CCPs over the last year. But it's exploratory, so it won't be resulting in capital recommendations in the way that the bank stress test might. And just on the international side, the FSB put out its progress report a couple of months ago, but by the end of next year, the FSB will have reviewed the action jurisdictions have taken or proposed to take on money market funds, and already there's been action proposed by the SEC on that. It'll be coming forward with recommendations on liquidity management tools for open-ended funds. It'll be coming forward with conclusions on how to ensure margin call from CCPs and bilaterally is not unnecessarily pro-cyclical. And it'll be looking at some of the roles that leveraged investors played in core funding markets and doing a pilot on collecting data in this area, which is one of the biggest issues. So by the end of the next year, we're due to come out with policy recommendations. Whether they will be sufficient or not will depend on the will of the international community to tackle this. I think you're right that from 2010 to 2017, I think, when the FSB made its first recommendations, the international community was slow, despite the FPC pushing hard on this. I think the dash for cash that the governor mentioned, the things we've seen in Archegos, the things we've seen in commodity markets, have made people much more aware of how liquidity resilience in non-bank finance can cause systemic issues. And I think there is more of a will to tackle these problems. But we'll know by the end of next year what we've come up with.
Francine, and then after that, Dave.
Thank you so much. Good morning, Francine Lacqua, Bloomberg TV. It might be a bit too early, but do you already have an indication of where the main vulnerabilities for these non-financial stresses could be that we should look at now, not to wait next year? And I think we have the SEC just put out a statement on FTX and its founder. Like, what's your take on it?
Well, I think in terms of where... where are the particular problems in the non-bank sector? I'd say two things. I mean, John has described the exploratory scenario. I think it's very important that we look across the sort of the landscape on that. But the challenge we face is this, in doing so. We've got to get a combination of both breadth and depth. And the reason for that is illustrated by the LDI funds, actually. I would say that there are three underlying causes of the problem in the LDI funds and why it was particularly a problem in the pooled funds. So the three are this. One, obviously, was the unprecedented movement in long gilt yields. The second one was the degree of leverage that had been taken on. And by the way, the evidence that we have suggests that the pooled funds had higher leverage than the so-called segregated funds, the single pension fund funds. And the third one is, and this is particularly why I make this point about breadth and depth, there was effectively a structural problem in there, which was embedded in, and particularly embedded in the pooled funds, if you like, it was a collective action problem, that given the first two things, the solution to the first two things is the so-called rebalancing of assets, so liquidity moves from the parent fund to the pooled fund. But there was a structural governance problem in there about how you did it in the time available, given the scale of the shock and therefore the need. And the reason I say that is because we've got to sort of, say, get this, you know, careful combination of breadth and depth so that we uncover that sort of issue across what is a very broad landscape. So it's not a matter of us having a sort of hidden list of things that we think are the problem. It's how we focus on what I think are the underlying sort of issues here, which is the potential for sudden demands for liquidity, the role of what we tend to call hidden leverage, in the sense that it's not as obvious as it is in banks, where you can reduce it to a ratio, and how we get this depth and breadth combination. And therefore, we'll have to structure the test. And indeed, the international work has to focus this, because there's a lot of work the FSB does on vulnerability assessment, which we're part of, as to how we get this right balance so that we can, we can uncover those areas that need to be uncovered. Sorry, you asked about FTX as well, didn't you?
Oh,
did they? Yeah.
Right.
Well, I mean, obviously, we saw last night that there'd been also judicial action. So, I mean, it is obviously, I think FTX is very much an issue for the US, given the domicile and the nature of it. But obviously, the implications of it in this broader sense that we've been talking about flow out from there. I mean, as you know, I've taken a pretty sort of strong line on crypto that I don't think, and I distinguish crypto from stablecoins here, by the way, just to be clear. So on crypto, that it doesn't have intrinsic value, and that if people wish to invest in it, well, they must be prepared to lose their money. Now, there may still be a case for investing. People buy things because of their extrinsic value. But we have to be very clear what it is.
Dave and then Fiona.
David Robinson, Market News. In light of the actions the bank took over LDIs, are you now looking to either rethink, codify, or formalise the bank's operations as market maker of last resort? Because it seems to be done on a very ad hoc basis. No one quite knows what your decisions are, what your criteria are. And also, as you're making the recommendation from the FPC now, why wasn't it made before? That is on the strengthening of LDIs, the resilience of LDIs to the pension fund regulator.
Well, I might take in two parts. I might, John, come in on the second part. On your point about market maker of last resort operators, it's a very good point, actually. So we have been, focused on how we would conduct operations in respect of liquidity needs in the non-bank sector. But more particularly, I think it's important to take it a step further and say where there is a need for the central bank to play a role which goes beyond the channeling of liquidity to the non-bank sector through the banking sector. See, the traditional model, if you like, is we put liquidity into the banking sector where it's needed, and it finds its way out to the places that it needs to find its way out to. And I think we have to conclude, and I go back to this point I made earlier about the shift in the relative sort of size of the bank and the non-bank sector, that we can't always rely on that mechanism now to work. Not a criticism of the banks. I think we just have to accept that this change in relative roles and relative scale introduces that risk and that therefore that need. Now, we have been working therefore for a little while on how we could, how we could do that, but how we could do that within what I might call the sort of the normal conventions of how central banks operate in markets, because we do not want to start creating the moral hazard that we will intervene in the world wherever the world needs intervening, come what may, sort of thing. And the second thing is more sort of, if you like, sort of operationally, how would we conduct operations with a very large range of counterparts who are not our regular counterparts and with whom we have no direct relationship, either through sort of normal market operations or indeed as a micro-regulator, I should say, as well. We've been working on how we could conduct repo operations, because repo tends to be our standard way of putting liquidity in against security. That work is continuing. We've also done work internationally on that, and the BIS published a report which we had quite a large role in, and that will continue. But let me just say, LDI actually illustrates the challenges in this area, and I'll just give you a sort of sense as to, you know, what went on in this building, if you don't mind, because it might help to, I don't know, it might bring it to life or not. I don't leave you to judge. I mean, we spent, you know, we burnt the midnight oil, frankly, trying to work out, could we actually do operations directly targeted into the either the LDI funds or the main or the parent pension funds, because the point I was making earlier about rebalancing of assets, of liquidity, was moving liquidity from the parent funds into the LDI funds. Ultimately, I think if you say, well, why didn't you do that? Number of things. One was the LDI funds actually didn't have the assets for us to repo against. The parent funds did, but the governance, particularly in the pooled funds, there was, I think, a sort of collective action governance challenge in that area, I think would have made it very complicated for us to be sure that that would have worked within the time available. The third one is actually rather more practical, but we have to solve this. I mean, if you ask the question, how many pension funds do you think sort of underlie the pooled LDI funds? I think the numbers that we've calculated is certainly at least sort of somewhere around 1,800. And now, you know, for us to operate with 1,800 counterparties is a pretty tall order. So, yeah, we're still very much focused on that, but I think that gives, you know, the non-bank world is a challenge in that sense. And frankly, going back to the midnight oil being burned and bringing it to life, yeah, there came a point when we realised that that was not going to work as a strategy in that context, and therefore we switched to the more broad market intervention of purchasing gilts. I mean, obviously targeted on the areas that we knew the LDI funds were going to have to sell in.
John, yeah, I'll say a few words on the recommendation. So the FPC ran a simulation back in 2018 about what would happen to pension funds, insurance companies, hedge funds, with a 100 basis point increase, equivalent to 100 basis point increase in long gilts. And that showed that liquidity management in pension funds, insurance, etc., you know, needed to take more account of that. And we worked with the pension regulator to get more information on what was happening and to advise funds more strongly that they needed to manage their liquidity. So the question is, what changed between that and post-LDI? I'd say two things in particular. One, we saw actually in COVID, and I mentioned this before, and we saw in the stress incident in September, October, moves that were beyond historical experience. So long gilts moved, I think, by 130 basis points between the mini budget or fiscal event and the point at which we came in. I think the largest move over 4 days, the largest move we'd seen before, was around 30 basis points. So we saw moves outside historical experience. We saw that as well in the COVID dash for cash in other areas. So one reason is we now need to think that stress tests calibrated on the past may not show enough and you need more resilience. The other is that the point that Andrew just made, which is, I think, one in three pension funds has less than 100 members. So if you look at these LDI strategies, 75 to 80% of them are done by large funds that weren't actually causing the problem in this case. But it is the 20%, or actually less by value, which were these pooled funds of very small investment funds offered to very small pension funds that caused the problem. And the problem was twofold. One was that the funds in question didn't have the mechanisms for getting the liquidity, the pension funds didn't have the mechanisms for getting the liquidity and the capital into the investment funds, and we couldn't lend to the pension funds because, as was just said, there are just too many of them. And the other, I think, is they hadn't been managing, as gilt yields have been moving over the past year, they hadn't really been managing their buffers quickly enough. These are slow-moving animals, if I can put it that way, and the governance and organisation of those funds just doesn't make them react very quickly to market movements. And those are lessons learned, and we've said clearly there need to be lessons learned, and that's why I think we need to have standards. What we've put in place now is a temporary recommendation that says they should hold on to the resilience that they have that would enable them to meet a rise in long gilt yields to about 7%. That's what they have at the moment. and that's what the recommendation says. But in the medium term, we need to come up with steady state rules, not just on guidance, not just on liquidity buffers, but also on organisation and governance, so that when you hit these ahistorical stresses, because we're living clearly in a world in which we've seen a number of things outside historical experience in markets, you can move the liquidity quickly. I'll make one final point. This is not about the solvency of pension funds. When interest rates go up, pension funds' actual solvency improve because the value of their liabilities goes down. This is about being able to deal with the liquidity requirements of leverage strategies. And if you can't deal with, if you like, the liquidity requirements of a leverage strategy when it's under stress, then that leverage strategy is not appropriate to you. And that's where we'll have to come out. Thank you.
So I've got Fiona and then Laura.
Fiona Maxwell from MLEX. So my question is on banks rather than non-banks. So the consistent conclusion from the bank, from the FPC, is that banks are resilient, record levels of capital and liquidity. A couple of weeks ago, we had the proposals from the PRA on Basel 3.1. You said unlikely to significantly increase capital requirements, but probably there will be a little bit of rebalancing. So is that necessary, given your consistent positive view of bank capital?
One for Sam, I think.
Yes, nice to have a question on banks. Thanks, Fiona. There's a good chart in the report which shows what's happened on bank capital, which is a broad build up until a couple of years before COVID, where we got up to sort of a cruising altitude, which in our system is around 14% of CET1, a temporary step up during COVID because of safety first actions by us and also by the banks, and then it coming down again to that cruising altitude. As you've rightly picked up, we do not expect our proposal to implement an occlusion in the name here, but we call it Basel 3.1 for a reason. In a sense, we don't think that's going to lead to a very big further increase in capital, but it is completely necessary to do it. And the reason, Fiona, is this, that we've discovered that when we take the same group of assets and put them through different banks' risk weighting engines, and this, by the way, is done internationally in Basel with all of us contributing, we get completely indefensible differences in terms of the amount of capital requirement that spits out of those different banks' calculations. And you know, in the most extreme cases, you have a factor of 13 times different between the most conservative bank and the least conservative bank. And these reforms are designed to tackle that problem. There's a few other things in there as well, but that's really the heart of it. And if we don't do that, I think what will happen is that the main plank of the bank capital regime globally, which is the risk-weighted regime and is what all these numbers like 14% are expressed in, will simply fall away because people will rightly lose confidence in it. So that's why we've got to do it. And I think it's particularly important that here in the UK, having just left the EU, as the host of a very large global financial centre, we are seen to be a pragmatic but a robust implementer of the international standard, because that's part of our licence to operate a very large financial centre.
So I've got Laura and then Anna.
Hi, thank you, Laura Noonan from the Financial Times. Governor, in your opening statement, you referred to the culture around the fact that we're not entering a deregulatory era and the kind of trying to get the balance right between fitting the rules for the UK. When you think about what the government announced last week, do you think that they have got the balance right, or are there any parts of that concern you? Thank you.
Well, I think it's, as I said, it's important to recognise that Brexit is is an important sort of moment in time, and it's right that we review the regulation that we've inherited from the past, because that regulation is designed for a union of what was 28, now 27 countries, and of course the UK is a single currency case. And you know, just take Solvency II as the example. Much of the underlying issue with Solvency II was that it was a very complex piece of regulation designed to cover what was sort of assumed to be a single European insurance market, when certainly in the area of life insurance, the product mixes across the countries were very different. I mean, we had the UK has a very different product mix in terms of life insurance products to other parts of Europe. And so it naturally follows that it's right to review that and change it as appropriate. And so I think last week's announcement, in a sense, is very much reflective of that. The point I made this morning is that Yeah, there's a second reason, let me say, for having a review, because obviously it's been rightly pointed out that ring fencing and the senior managers regime, for instance, are not EU regulations. In fact, the EU actually did not go down either of those routes. But I would also say, you know, it's important that, you know, always regulation has to be kept up to date. So the idea that we never review anything and that these things are sort of set in stone for all time, of course, that would actually be a road to problems, actually. So it's right that we do that. What I do say, however, and I'll just reiterate what I said, is I think it's important, though, to recognise that the regulatory initiatives that have happened post the financial crisis, and of course Sam has just been describing, if you like, the sort of last part of that in the banking world, were done for an important reason. I mean, it was a very, very painful, very, very difficult experience. So accepting, you know, the point that it's, you know, there are reasons why we'll review and change things, I would, however, caution that the notion that we're past the financial crisis and we therefore don't need the regulations that we had post the financial crisis, I would not go along with that view, because I think we have to you know, understand clearly why the banking system is much more robust today than it was then. And, you know, regulation, of course, isn't the only contributor to that, but it is an important part of that story. Well, I think there are people out in the outside world who are suggesting that. I think it's therefore just important to make clear that, you know, the basis on which the regulatory system we have today, a lot of which was changed, particularly in the banking system post-financial crisis, was not done just to address a particular problem that then went away. It was done, you know, to put down some, you know, what I would regard as pretty fundamental planks of the regulatory system. So, you know, I'll just give you one. I mean, the senior managers regime moved us from a world where the judgment was one of culpability to the world where the judgment was one of responsibility, and I think that has created an altogether, you know, helpful dynamic in that sense.
Thanks. Anna next, sorry, behind you, I think.
It's Anna Wise from Press Association. I just wanted to touch on, in the report you're talking about households being more resilient than before the crisis. And that many are tied to fixed rate mortgages, so the impact of rate rises hasn't hit them yet. But then you talk about 4 million being due to face increases next year of around £250. I just wondered if you can explain a little bit more about why you think they're in a position to withstand this increase and why it is that it won't lead to material losses for banks this time around.
Well, I think there's several thoughts behind that. So let me start. I think it's absolutely, the first thing we should say about this is that, you know, there is nothing, you know, easy about the situation we're in at the moment, that we are very conscious of the effects it's having on households, very conscious of that. And you're right that, 4 million households in this country are exposed to rate rises over the next year. That's obviously a very substantial number. There are two things I would draw out there to underpin the point I made about the current situation. One is that if you take the aggregate mortgage, you know, debt service ratio now, it is lower than it was, for instance, before the start of the financial crisis and at the time of the early 1990s recession, when we had quite a severe, obviously, mortgage and housing crisis. We've also, obviously, through the work of the FPC, put in place the framework on high loan to income borrowing. That is actually also the tail of the distribution of high loan to income borrowing is now smaller, appropriately smaller, and that will also increase the robustness of households in that sense. That's the first point. The second point is to just reemphasize the points I made at the end of my opening comments. First of all, I mean, two parts to this. First of all, banks are now required by regulation to, frankly, support their customers through these problems more than they did in the past. So in other words, they can't resort to repossession with the speed that has gone on in the past. But there's a second part to that, which I think is very important, and it's the part I really emphasised at the end of my opening remarks, which is this, that of course a more robust, a financially robust banking system will be better placed to do that. I mean, that their resources will be better placed to support their customers. We saw that during COVID with mortgage holidays. The banking system will be better placed to support their customers, and therefore, I very much hope and believe that more customers will be supported through this, and we won't get the level of repossessions, and of course, therefore, the level of loan losses that went on in the past. You want to add anything?
Yeah, I'd perhaps just add a couple of numbers to that as well. So household debt to income is about 20 percentage points lower now than it was during the financial crisis. And actually, household leverage has gone down in part because of some of the measures the FPC put in place, actually on mortgage and mortgage underwriting standards. We're forecasting numbers in the FSR, that kind of average DSR will go up from about 5% of income to 7.5%, and that's looking at 9%, 10% in the financial crisis and in the big housing stress that we had at the beginning of the 1990s. Loan-to-value ratios are much stronger now, which means that fewer people will be in negative equity. The governor said that banks are now required to support customers and crucially have the strength to be able to do that. And that goes back to some of the earlier points, I think, in answer to Laura's question on resilience in the banking sector. So one wouldn't expect anything like the degree of foreclosures and forced sales that you saw in the 1990s. What you might expect, and I think this is something the MPC has commented on in the November NPR, is that, of course, households will be squeezed and that will affect their consumption. So this will not be necessarily an easy time. But whether that leads to the sort of stresses we've seen earlier in the UK housing market really depends on the resilience of households and the resilience of banks. And that suggests, I mean, the numbers suggest we are in a much better position than, say, the early 90s, which is the last time we had sort of interest rates going up at a time of inflation and house prices. Financial crisis, interest rates and inflation went in the other direction.
Thanks. Okay, and then Tom, I think, and then we'll...
Okay, thank you very much. I'm Kohei for Nikkei. And there will be the meeting of the G7 finance ministers and the central bank governors in Japan next May. So what do you think should be discussed as a central banker in terms of global financial stability?
Well, it's of course, it is a little while till the G7 meeting in Japan, so we'll see what, of course, happens. But I can tell you that... throughout this year, the G7, of course, has been discussing, during the German presidency, the G7 has been actively discussing the state of the world economy. As you'll imagine, we've had a particular focus on the impact of the awful developments in Ukraine. And that has obviously had a big impact on G7 discussions, the economic impact of what Russia is doing in Ukraine. I wish I could say that we wouldn't have to do that next year, but I'm afraid, as things stand now, I suspect we will be discussing the situation in Ukraine further. And of course, the G7 discussions of finance ministers and governors then, in a sense, go on from there to therefore discuss the impact of that on the world economy and what each of us is doing to address that. And I look forward to the Japanese presidency, and I'm sure they'll be taking it forward. I know my Japanese colleagues are already very actively planning it, and we really welcome the work the Japanese presidency are already doing.
So I've got Tom, and then Will.
Sorry. Cheers. Tom Reed from The Telegraph. On the housing market, the report mentions growing pressures on many buy-to-let landlords from higher interest costs. How big an issue do you think this will be for that part of the market? And will they worsen the slump in house prices by being forced to sell the properties?
Yeah, so I think one is seeing a slowing down in the in the buy-to-let market. Buy-to-let is 80-90% of the mortgage stock at the moment. The sector is more resilient, again, FPC, following FPC analysis back in 2016, the underwriting standards for buy-to-let were tightened, the income coverage ratio and LTV. So the sector is stronger. The LTVs are normally lower than in the residential market. So there's more of a cushion there. But of course, a number of things are happening in that market, not just mortgage costs. You're seeing legislation on tenancies. There have been tax changes as well. So it may well be that a number of buy-to-let landlords who came into the market over the last 10, 15 years will seek to come out and perhaps take capital profits. That will affect house prices. But of course, house prices have gone up nearly 20% over the last 2 years. So if you think about it, there is a lot. There is a lot of space before you start to see sort of negative equity and distressed sales. But I think a slowing of buy-to-let and buy-to-let activity kind of could affect the market as a whole. I just go back to the earlier point I make. I think this is going to be more a question of kind of the market slowing, maybe the market falling from some of the highs it's seen over the last 2 years. But it doesn't look like a 1990 style kind of forced sales driving house prices down in a large way. Of course, our stress test we're doing now of the banks, tests banks to a fall in house prices of over 30%. That's been a regular feature of our stress test. So on the banking side, we think the resilience is there.
Ian, do you want to go now since you've got it in your hand, and then Will, you have your hand up. No, that's all right.
Ian Withers from Reuters. You've said you'll monitor banks to ensure they don't overly tighten credit. How do you think you'll do that, and what might intervention look like if you were to do that? And just to follow up on LDI, you said they need bigger buffers. Well, is there a chance that gets passed on to pensioners in terms of higher fees? Thank you.
Sam, do you want to take the...
Yes, so can we include what I think is quite a useful chart in the report, which looks at that question, Ian, and looks at what's been happening with banks' net interest margin, which is one aspect. It's not the only aspect, but it's one aspect of that question. And what you'll see there is that those margins have rebounded back to a bit, but not very much, above the average level they're at 2011, 2019. That itself followed, of course, a very significant drop with the financial crisis. And in between those two periods, we had a further drop down to a lower level, driven first of all by an intense kind of competition in the mortgage market, and that rolled straight into COVID. So I think as far as what banks are doing at the moment is, we're seeing a return, rebuilding those margins to something that is more normal based on historical experience. It's also normally the case that banks will make more money when rates are going up, because assets tend to be more sensitive than liabilities to that change in the environment. We'll obviously be keeping an eye on that going forward. We're also looking at other changes that banks are making in terms of their lending to the economy. They are tightening a bit, but for higher risk lenders, and in a way that we think is appropriate from a risk management point of view. What would we do if we changed that view? Well, we have a number of tools at our disposal. The communication tool is actually quite effective, but this is also relevant to the countercyclical buffer, in that, you know, we're confident that the right thing to do at this point is to build in that neutral rate in order that the banks can carry on supporting the economy in the way that they've done to date. And on the LDI buffers, perhaps I'll pass to John.
Yeah, look, I think it'll be for the pension regulator to opine about what funds need to do and the sponsors of pension funds to do. The key point here is, if you run a leveraged LDI strategy, you have to be prepared to deal with the liquidity consequences of that. And it may be that means that for some pension funds, LDI strategies are not quite as attractive, or they'll have to rebalance in some other way.
I mean, there's a key point, just to emphasize what John has said about risk management. Yeah. I mean, you know, there is a key responsibility here for LDI funds and their managers to, you know, carry out, of course, appropriate risk management, and of course for the trustees and funds to oversee that, because unsustainable returns will not end well in that sense.
So I might I might perhaps make a point on that, which is what happened in this incident is a number of the LDI funds that were the investments for pension funds and the pension funds themselves had to sell assets. They sold corporate bonds, they sold gilts, which are their hedges, in a stress, and they sold them at low prices in order to raise the liquidity, and that's not good for them either. So looking at the thing in the round, recognising the true costs of running strategies that require liquidity in stress is not a bad thing for pension funds. It's probably a good thing.
A quick question for Sam Woods about Brexit and the ECB desk mapping exercise. So Goldman Sachs is moving its Euro swaps trading desk from London to Milan. Citi's moving its head of European markets from London to Paris. Are you concerned about London losing some of its financial standing as the ECB keeps pressuring trading jobs to move away from the UK? And how many of those roles do you think might eventually have to move over time, do you think, please?
Thanks, Will. That's something, obviously, we've been spending quite a bit of time on. The short answer to your question is that, at the moment, I'm not concerned about that. The reason for that is that it was always clear that with passporting falling away as part of Brexit and various other changes, that our colleagues in the ECB would require more entities in the EU, and as part of that, there will be some staffing implications. So that's always been, I think, kind of priced in, at least certainly from our point of view. Our key interest has been in making sure that any changes that take place are based on proper regulatory concerns and are not a kind of land grab. And secondly, that the new structures, which are, of course, a bit more complex than what we had before Brexit, can be overseen and also manage risk properly within the firms. And on both of those scores, I think we're fine. Looking at it slightly more broadly in the context of your question about numbers, I don't want to give you a specific number today. What I would say is that one of the consulting firms publishes quite regularly jobs numbers that have gone across. I think the latest number was about 7,000 overall, but that's wider than the desk mapping review, of course. And as far as I can see, that's a reasonable number. That's at the lower end of some of the numbers that were being talked about prior to Brexit. And in the round, we've had a very good interaction, of course, not the most straightforward, but a good interaction with our colleagues at the ECB on this. And I think a reasonable compromise is being established between the various interests people have.
Although it's a smaller number than have moved in the past, is it more important and more significant now because the ECB is going after front office jobs like trading rather than like back office compliance roles like it was in the immediate years after the Brexit vote?
No, I don't think so, Will, because the ECB has always been clear that part of not having an empty shell or brass plate in their jurisdiction meant having some first-line staff in their jurisdiction. We understand that point because we make the same point ourselves, but it's just a question of degree. And as I say, I'm really not concerned. The numbers that we're talking about on traders remain a very small fraction of the trading population here in London.
Okay, is there anyone who's not asked a question who wants to come in? Sarah, go ahead.
Hi there, Sarah Tapp-McGuire here from Sky News. I'm wondering, why haven't market fixed rate mortgages come down? Governor, I know you said that they had been too high and they haven't fallen down. Why is it the market doesn't believe you and they haven't come down to pre-mini budget rates?
Well, we've seen some reduction in new fixed rate mortgage rates since then. So I wouldn't say they've not come down, actually. We have seen some reduction. We follow it very closely. I mean, and we will continue to follow it very closely to see how it evolves. I mean, I think there's always a case where the market, you know, will probably, you know, wish to see the evidence that things are returning to normal. Now, by the way, I do think in terms of, you know, interest rate conditions in that sense, the sort of what I might call the UK risk premium that we saw over that September-October period has certainly, if you do the international comparison, which is one way of doing it, I think that has eased quite considerably. So there has been some reduction, and I will be interested to see what happens next. Sorry, John.
No, I'm just. I'm looking at it. I think there is a chart in the FSR that shows this, which is the mortgages are normally priced off the the two-year or the equivalent swap rate. But in the years leading up to COVID, the margin over that swap rate had become very compressed. And I think some of that was to do with competition in the mortgage market and also a lot of banks looking to increase market share. But if you look at it over a longer timescale, that spread over the swap rate has been higher. So I think the rates are coming down slowly for two reasons. One, because banks reset them slowly, so you wouldn't expect them to come down as quickly as the market rate they're priced off. But two, we might see that that compression in the spread that we saw in the years before COVID, spread goes back more to historical averages, which means that they will be about higher going forward relative to the swap rate than they were in the immediate years before COVID. That's a useful chart, I think. I have to find it in the FSL.
Again, is there anyone who's not asked a question? Otherwise, I'll let Phil sneak in for a second. Well, now's a chance to stop him. No, go on, Phil. Last question.
Thanks. The LDI blowup just revealed that when concerns about inflation get into markets, it can create financial stability concerns. With that in mind, and considering you've talked about pay restraint in the past and the importance of pay restraint, do you stand by your previous comments that it remains very important, pay restraint, and is the government's stance on public sector pay restraint important in this inflationary context?
I'm tempted to say that's straying into monetary policy, I think.
It's got a financial stability element to it, I think, given the blow-ups that could be caused.
Well, I think I've answered the question on pay restraint quite a few times this year. I really don't have anything new to say on it. Really, it's not for me to get into the question of public versus private sector. I mean, I'll just reiterate two points I've made repeatedly, so I'm not saying anything new this morning. I think I'll just preface what I say by that. The first one is this, quite simply. I mean, this is an external shock, predominantly, that we're experiencing, and that causes a real income effect, a loss of real income in the UK. The risk that we face, as we've said before, is the so-called second-round effects, which come from both price setting and wage bargaining. And that obviously remains very much our focus. The second point, and I've made many times, and I've always prefaced this by saying it, I think it probably does stray strictly beyond the bank's remit, but I'm going to say it because I think when I go around the country, I think many firms say to me that they are adapting their pay settlements to give more to low-paid workers, and I think that is entirely sensible given the nature of the inflation that we're facing at the moment, because it is very concentrated in what you might call the essentials of life. I think if I go any further, I think I'll be guilty of breaking the rule on monetary policy, so I'm not going to do that.
All we've got time for. Thanks so much for coming, everyone, and I do hope you manage to get a break over Christmas. See you in the new year.
Yes. Cheers.